welcome to the Center for Spiritual
Chum.
Living. Welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living, where the love is.
Here we go. Good morning. Wow, I have lost my microphone. It's hidden somewhere on this body temple. Good morning and welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living here in Boise, Idaho. I'm Reverend Jackie Holland, and it is my honor, my privilege, my delight to welcome you here to Facebook Live, this morning's Sunday service celebration with the magnificent Blaze and Kelly. Let's just give them a hand. Woo! I was having a conversation with Nicole the last couple of days where I was saying to her how much that everyone is missing going to see them. And then I had to laugh to myself and say, yeah, but a couple of times I've had a private concert at the CSL. Yes. So welcome on this Memorial Day weekend, where we just celebrate the life and the love of God in and through each other. I just want to just remind you that as you're watching us in your homes, that at 11:45 today, we will have a Zoom call, and that information is in your e-blast or on the cslboise.org website. You can check that out and join us at 11:45 and see each other's faces, and maybe Blaze and Kelly will stop in and say hello to you, and we'll just have a wonderful time. So please, in the next hour, just connect with that so you know how to do it. And this morning, we are so magnificently supported by the CSL House Band under the direction of Maestro Rex Miller, our musical director. And we have with us this morning Phil Bowden on the drums. Phil celebrated, this week, Phil celebrated his birthday, his daughter's graduation from BSU Nursing School. Yay, Carly, congratulations, we're so proud of you. And in addition to that, he is celebrating the birth of his first grandchild to be. When is that baby due? That baby is due in September, and this week they had a big celebration as family. Don't you love that? Don't you love the family? We're so delighted to welcome you here this morning. Let's just take a deep breath together. And let's just take a moment. I'm going to ask you to please go get one of our little tissue things, our cleaning things. Sorry, just take a deep breath right here. We are in the sanctuary this morning, socially distancing with our camera woman. Thank you so much, JJ. Our camera woman, Cheryl, our sound person, Thomas. We're just socially distancing this morning as we come together to bring this service to you. So take a deep breath with me. I ask you to contemplate this morning as you prepare for the service. How is your body? Just do a check-in. How is your body? How is your mind? Open and receptive. How is your heart? Loving, deepening. So blessed to have Lisa Compton as our practitioner of the day, bringing forth our spiritual practices and holding the high watch for us this morning. So just prepare yourself as you listen to the sounds of Rex Miller.
It is my honor to introduce Rob Compton, who will light the world religion candles from the Christ candle. In religious science, we perform this ceremony to acknowledge that all people and all faiths come from the one great universal presence which we call spirit. In lighting these candles, we honor the one family of humanity made up over 4,000 religions and spiritual traditions throughout the world. We light the first candle for Confucianism. Confucianism taught the way of harmony and propriety. We light the second candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. We light the third candle in honor of Islam, which honors the path of submission to the will of God as the highest calling. We light the fourth candle for Universalistic Religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and peace. The fifth and final candle honors all forms of new thought, which believes peace is brought about by knowing our infinite nature of God, which cannot be disturbed. So let's quiet our minds and open our hearts for the magnificent message being sung by Blaze and Kelly.
Gonna sing you a lullaby, soft and gentle, baby, don't you cry. Gonna sing you a lullaby, gonna sing you a lullaby. I'm gonna sing you a lullaby. Close your eyes and find sleep. Everything's okay, so don't you weep, cause good dreams sure come. Rest your head from the day that's done tomorrow. It's a new day.
Nothing bad
is here to stay. I will blow across your mind. Ride along on the wind. Everything that goes will come back again. You can hold on to that string. Sometimes the holding is the only thing. I'm gonna sing you a lullaby. It's the way I hold you. Let you fly. I'm gonna sing.
This lullaby, surrounded and saturated in the divine, in the awareness of God. I know that I am part of this beauty and this love and this lullaby, as we all are. And it's in this place of knowing that I am one with this, that we are all one in the divine, that I speak my word right here, right now, for all of us. We are all free. We are all standing in the love of the divine, and expresses in and through us. I speak a special word for our Reverend Jackie this morning as she stands up here in the freedom and the glory of God, expressing her divine light, sharing with us the message we all came to hear today. For this and so much more, I say Om, Shante, Ashe, Aho, Amen, and so it is.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary come to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she's standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be. Let it be, whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see, there will be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mama Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. 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 Whisper words of wisdom. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
Blaze and Kelly, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, Blaze and Kelly. Aren't we blessed that we have them here today to celebrate on this wonderful weekend? If you're interested in knowing about Blaze and Kelly, because things are opening up just a little for our musicians, and they do have some gigs scheduled, please go to blazeandkelly.com. Is that what it is? Blazeandkelly.com, and find out what's happening this week. This week, you can. There are a couple places you can go. So check out blazeandkelly.com. So good morning, and I'm so delighted to have you with us this morning. I want to start our talk this morning, which is called Making Elegant Choices, or the freedom to make elegant choices. I'm reminded of a story about one snowy night in Vermont. A large group of rowdy teenagers got together and probably had too much Boone's Farm. Oh, no, that was my generation. But anyway, and they broke into an empty summer house near Middlebury College. It was a lot of drinking and partying and breaking things and messing up the carpet. Anyway, it was about $10,000 worth of damage that these teenagers did. By the way, this was in 2008. You can look this case up.
So the offenders were caught, of course, and that's when things got really interesting. Things got really interesting at this point. Since the house belonged to one of the greatest poets in our country, Robert Frost, the kids were sentenced to poetry. $10,000 worth of damage, and this wise judge sentenced these teens to study poetry. That's right, poetry. You could call it poetic justice, I bet. According to the New York Times, the criminal justice system then called on a man by the name of Jay Perini, who was a Robert Frost biographer, and he was writing a book about Robert Frost and why poetry matters. And he was given the assignment by this judge to work with these teens and to use poetry both to punish and to rehabilitate them. Wow. Now, I've worked with a lot of teens in my life, and I'm just not sure that I thought that would have a good outcome. But believe it or not, I want you to know, apparently it did. His greatest lesson, of course, revolved around the poem, The Road Not Taken, which begins with these words. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood. Think about this. We're standing right now on the precipice of choice. Many roads diverging. I want you to know that it worked with these teens because as they studied this poem, particularly as Frost concludes it by saying this, I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. This morning we're talking about choice, and we're talking about choice because this weekend celebrates, we can use that word, it memorializes, it acknowledges the deaths of our military men and women, dogs and animals and horses. In all of the wars, all of the U.S. wars, it commemorates their deaths. Some of those young men and women had choice. They made the choice to go into the service. They made the choice to fight so that we today can stand here with choice. We can stand here today because of the men and women who made the ultimate sacrifice. And so tomorrow, as we are listening to music and as we are cooking out and coming together with our friends, some of us for the first time in many months, as we are doing that, we can spend a moment recognizing that we have choice because some gave much and some gave all. So today we talk about the fact that we can live in a world of possibilities here in the United States of America. We have the possibility to be more than we have ever been before. And so my question is, why aren't we? Why are we not? I say it's because of one thing, because of one reason. We have not chosen to be conscious. We have not chosen to be conscious. We have not made the big choice that we all must make, which is that God is all. That which is within us, that which is without us, that we are making the conscious choice to come from that place of knowing who we are. Made in the image and the likeness and out of that which is God itself, the reality is that many, if not most of us, have not made the choice to be conscious, to be conscious of our heritage, to be conscious of who we are. Spirit did its part. Spirit did its part. But in order for it to express, it must have a recipient. It must have a receiver. It must be us. We must receive all the goodness that God intends for us, all the peace, all the love, all the joy, all the help, all the freedom that Spirit intends for us if we make a conscious choice to be conscious of this. Not to live like flotsam in the wind, not to live like a seed upon the wind, but to be in choice. I want to talk about choice today because a lot of men and women died for us to live in choice. I want to talk about choice. What kind of choices are we making? Every single one of us stands here today as a result of every choice we have ever made in our life. From the beginning of the moments we were birthed on planet Earth, we have been making choice. Maybe, quite frankly, before that, for all we know. We may have been making choices in another dimension, another realm, another lifetime that is impacting this one. That's another talk, I think. So we are where we are today because of choices that we have made. And where we go from here depends on the choices that we will make today and moving forward. When I was a little girl, I grew up with Brer Rabbit. Boy, am I aging myself. Now, there's a few people who have come to church today socially distancing, and some of y'all are too young to remember Brer Rabbit. Am I right? You probably don't even know who Brer Rabbit is. Brer Rabbit was a Disney character. Some of us old folks are remembering Brer Rabbit. No, let's say it was an Uncle Remus story. Okay, you guys have got to Google Brer Rabbit. I mean, it was the way young children in the 50s and 60s learned about morality and ethics through this crazy little dog-eared Brer Rabbit. Anyway, I want to tell you one story of Brer Rabbit. Brer Rabbit was invited to dinner by two of his friends. Brer Terrapin invited him to dinner, and Brer Possum invited him to dinner. Unfortunately, the dinner invitations were on the same day at the same time. Now, you're saying to yourself, well, why didn't he just choose one and let it be done? Well, because, you know, it's hard to do that when you're Brer Rabbit. So here's what he did. He went to the crossroads that was right in the middle of his two friends' house. And first he said, let's see, who should I have dinner with? Okay, I'll go to Brer Terrapin's house. And he started to run towards Brer Terrapin's house. And he got halfway there and he turned around and he said, no, I'll go to Brer Possum's house. And he turned around and he ran back to Brer Possum's house and did this for hours. Now the moral of this story is what? The moral of this story is that we have to make a decision in life when we are given an opportunity to do so. And by the way, that's every single moment of our lives. Now, how did this poor little ragamuffin Brer Rabbit end up? No dinner. Sometimes that's how our life looks. We have so many choices, so many decisions to make that one part of us will allow the decision to be made by default. That's how we got where we are today, by default. Allowing other people to make decisions for us. I don't need to get into politics now, but that's really quite a bit of what's going on in our world. Because of default, letting other people make choices for us, we often find ourselves in positions we don't want to be in. For example, when I was a little girl, I heard my entire life that I was going to be an attorney. I was going to be a lawyer, and I would have been a good one. But something changed for me. Something happened for me, and I made my own choice. When I went to college, I think about this and I think, where would I have been if I had allowed a choice to be made for me by default? By default. I'm going to ask the people in the back to please not be talking. Thank you. Sorry, those of you who are watching us on Facebook Live. I don't know if you can hear it, but our empty audience here with empty chairs, it resonates throughout the entire sanctuary and it multiplies, the sound multiplies. So, default. Another way we make a choice in life is by consensus. We look at everybody who is, we look at a choice that we have to make and we, I'm sorry, I'm a little distracted right in this moment. Let's start over if we can. We have choices made by default, and we have choices made by consensus quite often. I know that this is close to me right now because of choices and decisions that we are having to make in this church about opening the church or not opening the church and how difficult that is. consensus. You can ask 100 people, and 100 people will make a decision, and then you say, oh yes, that's got to be the right decision. That is making a choice through consensus. That is not making an elegant choice. That is not making an individual choice. That is about allowing other people to make choices for you. Our entire life, we have picked up limiting information from this herd mentality. It's time to move through. It's time to move through it. This week, we're talking about choices. The Hopi Indians have a saying. They say, we were made only to sing praises to God. And when they forgot that, their world fell apart. They forgot who they were. It fell apart. They forgot who they were, and they started getting involved with the details of the everyday life and everything going on, and their life turned upside down. I think that parallels our story right now. It's true for us today. We say it very glibly, but the truth is we really haven't believed that our only job is to represent God. We haven't made those choices out of our knowingness, out of our firm foundation of who we are and what we are. And only from that place can we make the right choices. Choices. I'm talking about living in the promise of an elegant choice. When you think about elegance, what do you think about? You think of Lisa Compton. She's so elegant. She's so beautiful. She's so refined. She's so beautiful. And that's a good elegance. But that's not the elegance I'm talking about when I talk about this kind of making the elegant choice. I'm talking about making the choice from the elegance that is within you. That is within you. I'm talking about the elegant choice internally. That when we evoke the truth, the naturalness of who we are, made in the image and the likeness and out of that which is God itself, when we evoke our choices from that place, all of our choices are elegant and all of our choices are right. The invitation is to make elegant choices, a choice that stimulates who you are, what you were created to be. A lot of people fought so that we could stand here in this place and have this choice, so that we don't have to live a life of being mediocrity. I always get that word wrong. Mediocrity. We don't have to live that life of vanilla, of beige, of coloring inside the lines. We can make every choice that we make from a place standing firm in who we are. Yes, consensus is important to listen to. And yes, sometimes choices will be made for us by default. I don't know how many of you would have made the choice to have stayed in your homes for 10 weeks. That was a choice made for you by default. Responsibility, science. So not all choices made by default are bad choices. We simply want to limit the number of choices that we make in our lives, either through consensus, because when we step into trying to make a choice from consensus, believe you me, you will not be able to please everyone, and most of the time, you cannot please yourself. Alan Cohen, of course, who's written so many amazing books, especially in his book, The Dragon Doesn't Live Here Anymore, he said this: most of the problems we find in our lives are not so much the result of wrong choices, but the result of making clear choices. He goes on to say this: when we allow our environment to tell us what kind of world we live in, then we will never make conscious choices. He said, if we want to move ahead in our lives, we must begin to make clear choices and take action on them. The moment, he wrote, we make a firm decision, the forces of the universe immediately set themselves in line to manifest that decision. That's a wonderful promise. The moment we are clear on our intentions, the moment we are clear on who we are, what we are, the expression, the holy, sacred, spiritual expression of who we are, the moment that we are clear on our intentions, it's as if more life-giving, life-supporting, everything that we need rushes in to support the decisions that we are making. That's a wonderful promise, I think. That if we can become clear on our intentions and become clear on the place from which we are making our choices, the universe will rush in to support us. In the Christian Bible, the first Kings 18:21 says this, "And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt you between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him." Here's what he was saying. Make up your mind. Make up your mind. Make up your mind from a clear place of intention. Not herd mentality. Not consensus. But from a clear place. From a clear place. The world will always tell you what it thinks you should do and you should be. But strong is the individual that can sit in their own silence and allow spirit to speak through their soul as they make choices. Last night I had an amazing opportunity. I know you guys hate it when I... never tell me anything because you're going to hear it at church. I'm kidding. No, I'm really kidding about that. I just want you to know that. But last night I had a wonderful opportunity. As you know, Blaze and Kelly have a Saturday night live stream where they do a concert every Saturday night at 7 o'clock. And, you know, just go on their website and you can hear all about it. And then afterwards they do a question and answer period. And I usually do not have time to stay at the question and answer period, but something whispered to me to stay. It just said, stay and see what's going on. And people get to ask them questions and get to talk to them. And it was fascinating to me to see the trail of the question about becoming famous, having fame, notoriety, and to watch musicians like Blaze and Kelly and others respond to the idea that that isn't why they make the choices that they make in their life. Are not based on gaining fame. But the choices that they make, particularly for these two women, as they spoke last night, the choices that they make are based on the gift that they have to give to the world. That it's all about expressing their gift. Would they like to be famous? Well, there seemed to be some debate between the two of them about it, but pretty much the answer is, of course, but not from the place of ego fame, but from the place of when we reach a place and we are making choices in our life to get to that place, it will be because of the gift that we have to give the world. Now, the reason I'm sharing this story with you within the context of this talk is this. They are very clear on their intentions and who they are. And what their gifts are. When we can be that clear, when the clamoring of the world, when we can shut the clamoring of the world out, when it is silent, and we can come from that place and make our choices, life will be sweet and wonderful. And we will be fulfilling the job that Spirit put us on planet Earth to do. To express ourselves, we can, with the gift that God gave us, we can only do that when we are making elegant choices from a place of naturalness, wholeness, and knowing that God is the very center and the circumference of our lives. Again, I quote, well, I just want to tell you first that I'm talking to myself this morning about choices. I'm talking to myself. About choices right now. As every faith leader in the United States and around the world also is making difficult, difficult choices and decisions. And some of us are making them by ourselves, and others, like me, are blessed to have a board of trustees and to have congregants that are open and receptive to being asked how they feel about opening our churches and coming back. Your board of trustees has made the decision to postpone the official wide opening of this church until the middle of June, based on where we see the numbers are going and the best experiences of other churches, some that are opening and closing because of infections, some that are perhaps more steeped in the research than we are. I'm talking to myself this morning because this was probably the most difficult decision that I have made in my 30 years of ministry. Because I want to open up. I want to be here. I want to have everybody around us. But the safety and the security and the health of our congregation is what's critical to us. It's not about numbers in a room. It's about knowing that everyone is safe and when we can come back together. So this talk about choice came about because of the difficulty and the heaviness of making choice. Do I make it by default? Do I allow somebody else to make the choice for me? Do I make it by consensus, where I ask everybody and 50% of you say come back, 50% of you say no, we're not ready? Do I make it by science? Do we make it by CDC recommendations? And finally, I decided as I was preparing this talk last night that we make it from the place of clear intention. Clear intention. And what is our intention for church? It is to spread the life-affirming, healing teaching of religious science, science of mind, to teach these spiritual principles for practical application in our everyday living, and we don't have to be sitting next to each other in order to continue to do that. This church is founded on the belief that we are all one. We don't have to be sitting next to each other to know our oneness. That we can be holding that consciousness for and with each other, and we can make the choice to support and to love and to continue to be a part of this church, whether the doors are open, whether we're sitting next to each other, or whether we are simply communing in spirit and praying with each other, as your practitioners do every single day. So the choice has been a difficult one. I wanted to open next week. I wanted us to come back together. But I think that if we know what our intentions are, then we can recognize that we can wait for it to be safer to come back together in this church. And in the meantime, know that we're watching the numbers, and if something changes, we will be coming back together. Moses, again, in the Christian Bible said this, "I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your seed may live." What he was saying here is that God Almighty cannot give us what we will not receive. That God Almighty, Spirit, life itself, universal intelligence, cannot give to us any more than we are open and receptive to receive. And that takes a conscious choice. Conscious choice. If we don't consciously choose to allow life to flow through us, then we are going to allow other people to make decisions about what we should be, what we should do. What Moses was trying to say to you was this, and to me is this: make your decisions for your life. Make elegant decisions for your life, because even God cannot make decisions for you. Even God cannot make your choice. God gave us everything. Gave us everything, everything. And it's within us, but we have to activate it by choosing. What choice are you making today? What choice are you making today? Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of religious science, said this: "We cannot live a choiceless life. Every day, every moment, every second, there is choice. If it were not so, we would not be individuals," he wrote. We have the right to choose what we wish to experience. I know this pandemic has been hard on all of us. So far, I have not met a person who has said, "Yay, 10 weeks of isolation, loving it." So far. Well, okay, there was that one introvert, my next-door neighbor that you know is the curmudgeon who never speaks to anybody. He's loving this, okay? I'm just saying, Frank, you're loving it. I know you are, buddy. But I know that wasn't a choice that you would have made. And what these Bible verses and what Ernest Holmes is trying to tell us, that in even in the midst of a choice that has been made for you by default, you still have the freedom to choose how you will deal with it. You have the freedom to choose the gifts of this situation. You have the freedom to choose how you are going to spend your time, as I have, mostly on the couch eating white flour. No, I'm just saying. I'm just speaking it. I'm just speaking the truth here. I have that choice. Again, Mo and Nicole were talking last night about all the time in the world to write, but how many other things have come up. You know what? That's a choice. And it's the right choice, because here's what I want you to know. I want you to know that there are no bad choices. There are no wrong choices. There are simply choices that did not work out the way we wanted them to. There are no bad choices. So you make a choice and you go down the road and you realize that that road isn't taking you somewhere. You have the choice to change your mind again. You have the opportunity to make an elegant choice. Because the bottom line is this: as hard as you might try to live a choiceless life, it is impossible. We do not live a choiceless life. I believe that the most elegant choice that we can make in our life is to be the best we can be in every situation. I believe the most elegant choice that we can make every moment of our life is to choose to say, what is it that I can bring forth myself in this moment? What elegant choice can I make? There will never be a time that we are not challenged. I know these times feel more difficult. The challenges feel bigger. But the reality is, that isn't true. We will never face a time in our life when we do not have to make choices. Not yet, anyway. Elegant choices were made by people who came before us, as Rex is coming up. Now, I want you to think about the men and women who made the choice in all of these wars, these difficult, difficult wars. Dr. Howard Thurman, who wrote a wonderful reading called The Strength to Be Free from his wonderful book, Meditations of the Heart. I just want to read a moment of that as Rex is playing for us. Take a deep breath. Give me the strength to be free. The thought of being free comes upon us sometimes with such power that under its impact, we lost the meaning that the thought implies. Often to be free means the ability to deal with the realities of one situation so as not to be overcome by them. It is the manifestation of a quality of being and a living that results not only from understanding one situation, but also from wisdom in dealing with the situation. It takes no strength to give up, to accept the shackles of circumstance so that they become shackles of the soul, to shrug the shoulders in bland acquiescence. This is easy. This is easy. But do not congratulate yourself, he says, that you have solved anything. In simple language, you have sold out, surrendered, given up. It takes strength to affirm the highest prerogative of your spirit. And you will be free when you recognize you are at choice. This weekend, we make a memorial for all the men and women who came before us to give us choice. And it is my honor just simply to turn within for a moment. Let there be peace on earth, we hear, with God as our Father. loved ones, all are we. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. This morning, we remember our military men and women who have died in the major wars in American history. 25,324 died in the American Revolution. 19,465 died in the War of 1812. 13,283 died in the Mexican War. The Civil War resulted in the deaths of 622,000 people. Spanish-American War, 2,400. World War I, 116,516 men and women. World War II, 403,339. The Korean War, 54,246. The Vietnam War, 58,220. The Persian Gulf War, 383. The Iraqi War, 4,401. The Afghan War on Terror, 1,076. Brave men and women who made the ultimate sacrifice so that we are free. Take a deep breath with me. So from this place, this sacred moment where we recognize the value and the honor of so many, we say thank you. Thank you to the military men and women, and thank you as we remember their families, their loved ones. And this morning, we speak a word for the almost 100,000 people that have died in this country of coronavirus. They're not military, but today on Memorial Day, we remember them and their families. And so from this place of faith and conviction, the word is spoken. The word is spoken for oneness and peace and love, generosity, abundance, help. The qualities of God that were so magnificently bestowed upon us the moment we came to planet Earth. And now we make the choice to live and breathe and have our very beingness in these qualities. Of spirit itself, expressing forever and ever, expressing itself through us. I say thank you, God. Thank you, spirit. Thank you, life. Oh, how good it is to stand in the awareness that we are all brothers and sisters in spirit, in God, in life. And so I declare, maintain, and affirm that there is peace on earth right now. And I affirm that there is wholeness and help and healing and a new way, day dawning for all of humanity. And for this I am so deeply grateful, so deeply grateful. Thank you, Spirit. Thank you, life. Thank you, God, for everyone that has requested prayer through our prayer ministry. We simply say, it is done. We hold you. We love you. We know you and we see you. Thank you, God. Let there be peace on earth. And let it begin with me. And so it is. Amen, amen, amen. Oh, thank you so much. I always kind of tear up at that Vietnam because that's my era, that's my generation, the men and women in my generation that fought. And yesterday I was speaking to a 22-year-old woman, on Friday I should say, I was speaking to a 22-year-old woman and somehow politics came up. Yeah, well, you know, it was me after all. And she said, well, I don't know much about politics. And I said, aren't you 22? And she said, yes. And I said, don't you have a daughter? And she said, yes. And I just shook my head. Now, the reason that I'm sharing that with you was because we started talking about the benchmarks of our lives. And I said to her, you know, the benchmark of my life was the Vietnam War. You know, that was just what defined my generation. The men and women in my generation was the Vietnam War. And the next generation, of course, was September the 11th. And your generation, I said to her, is going to be defined by this pandemic. Who were you? What were you? And what did you bring forth? And oh, we had just amazing talk. I love talking to young people about these kind of things, opening their hearts and their minds. Thank you for joining us today. If you're still with us, I'm just so glad that you're here. I want to tell you that if you want to receive prayer from the Center for Spiritual Living, just email us at prayers@cslboise.org. prayers@cslboise.org, or call our prayer line, or go on our website and you can leave your prayers there. You can also make your donations there at cslboise.org. Hit the donate button and it will tell you all about the many ways that you can give. And of course, we are receiving cash and checks through the mail. If you right now want to make a donation, you can send a quick text message and you can say, I'd like to give $10 million. Oh, okay, no. Maybe you want to give whatever the amount you want to give to CSL Boise's dedicated text giving number, which is this, 208-782-4202. 208-782-4202. And you'll get a confirmation, and it's all very safe. And once again, I want to just take these gifts, these offerings in my hands, and tell you how grateful we are on behalf of the Center for Spiritual Living here in Boise for all of your generous giving. We thank you as you continue to support your church in these times of closure, as we continue to do our work from an empty building. Remember, the church is not closed. Only the building is closed. But the church is still open and doing its work. How grateful we are as I say thank you. Let's just turn within for a moment as we bless the gift and the giver, knowing that this is multiplied in your own life as you participate in the law of circulation in your own life, giving back to your spiritual home. How good it is to participate in the giving and receiving of life itself. As together we say, divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I circulate. And so it is. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, the magnificent, the incredible Blaze and Kelly. Ready to come true.
wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where the troubles burn like lemon drops high above the chimney tops. That's where you find me, somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly. Dreams that you dared to, why, oh why can't I someday I wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where the shovels melt like lemon drops high above the chimney tops. That's where you find me, somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly, and the dreams that you dared to, why, oh why, and I.
Thank you. Have a beautiful, beautiful week. Wherever you are, please stand and accept this blessing. May the longtime sun shine upon you. All love surround you, and the very light within you guide your way home. Peace, y'all.
So it is.